It's 1854 in London, and for the last 8 years, there's been a cholera outbreak which has killed 3,000 people. And there's a new outbreak which has happened in Soho on Broad Street. And there are two schools of thought as to what caused cholera back then. Number one was that it was something in the air that you breathed in. That was the popular opinion. But there was a guy called Dr. John Snow who had another opinion, and that was that it was to do with germs and bacteria. So to prove it, he drew up this map. I'll zoom in a bit so you can see it. It's a bit macabre, but the black lines indicate deaths in the area from people who had cholera. And what's very interesting is when you look at this data, a very clear pattern emerges. The deaths are all central around that pump there. And this was one of the first bits of evidence he used. He went to the council, he got the pump where they didn't have taps, obviously, in those days, so people used to go into the street to get their water. And he got the council to remove the pump handle so no one could access any water from that pump. And the outbreak in that particular area stopped. It's one of the interesting things. If you have a hypothesis, you need to have data to back it up. And it's one of the earliest examples of data visualization. And I'm talking about activation here. For me, this is a good example of activating data. Here's another one. Digital marketing is difficult. There are a lot of different things you can concentrate on. How do you know how much you should be spending in SEO versus paid search? What about your email retention strategy? And there's this new thing called TikTok. Should you be on that advertising? How do you know? And if you're like most companies I see, every week you have a meeting to discuss these kind of things where all your different capability heads come in and they have these massive spreadsheets and they go through all the intricate details of all the campaigns and you're left completely bamboozled because typically people end up arguing whether the data is correct. Anyone in that situation? Yeah, a few nods? Okay, it happens a lot. So what we like to do is we like to take a step back and look at it from a kind of helicopter view. And we literally spend about 15 minutes. We can draw this up very quickly. I've blurred out some of the numbers. But if a client came to us and said, our revenue's gone down 12% compared to last year, rather than get into the weeds or just concentrate on a particular area, first I want to know what are the four levers that affect revenue. Well, we've got AOV, conversion rate, transactions, traffic. And it's quite clear that here is traffic and AOV are the problems. Now, if you don't do this, if you have all of your individual teams working individually, what's going to happen is you're going to plow money in equally into all of these things. Even though the CRO team's doing a great job, they've got conversion rate up, you might not know that if you're too busy in the weeds. But if you do something like this, which is very, very quick to do, and another example of activating your data, you can quickly see where the issues are. So here's a final example. It was my birthday in June this year, and every year, and it doesn't change. And this is Flight Club. Would you be able to play the video? So Flight Club, for those of you who don't know, takes the boring old concept of playing darts in a pub, and it takes it into a more social environment. But the great thing about Flight Club is that they have cameras on the dartboard, so when you throw the dart, it knows what your score is, so you don't have to do all the complicated maths. Not only that, but it records whenever you win a game. Okay, so whoever wins the game with the last dart, as you can see here, it records it, and then it plays it back to you in slow motion. Okay, so there you can see, that's what actually you got, and there's the reaction. And what's great about this is it then gets sent to you the day after. So I get sent it, and then I can share it, because it's a very, very shareable piece of content, and it's another great example of data activation. But the key thing is here, it's all automated. They don't have someone sitting in the background going, oh shit, someone's played another game, quick, record that, let's edit it together, let's send it out and do all that. It's all automated. You need to get to that stage because those are the companies who are succeeding, the guys who can activate the data. But there are various ways. Like I've talked about data visualization, I've talked about the more complex stuff of doing video and sending that out for personalized email, but there's so many other ways you can activate it. Another example, I used to work with a flooring company, and they used to send out free samples. So you could go to your website, you could order free samples, and they had hundreds of these things a day. And it was then up to the salespeople every day to come in the morning, pull up the list of everyone who'd ordered a free sample 3 days later, and call them up one by one. They didn't have the budget to call up every single person, so they literally probably did it by whose name do I like the look of, let's call them. If they had taken some other data sources, like how often that person had been on the website, the fact that beach is a top seller, so if they've ordered a beach sample, maybe that is that's a type of oak, not the holiday. If they'd ordered beach or oak, those are the top sellers, so let's prioritize those people. What they could have done is got their marketing team to deliver that list in the morning, and then it could have worked from the top, and it wouldn't have mattered if they didn't get to the bottom. So you can activate data in across all your channels, and that is the key. We're moving from a channel-centric approach, where all your teams work individually, to a more user-centric approach where they see the same message across all channels. And to do that, you have to be good at activating data. So I thought, this talk is after lunch, and it's notoriously the time where everyone's a bit dozy. So I thought, how can I make this talk more relevant to you? Can I apply these three stages, which is typically what you have to do? You have to collect data, analyze it, and then activate it. Could I apply that to a talk? And that's what I'm going to try and do. I'm going to try and personalize this talk based on the data you've given me and make it more relevant to you. Because ultimately, I don't want you going away aghast, not understanding what I've talked about, and really confused. I want you going away as happy customers. You can give me a standing ovation if you want. Okay, so that is why I had people down in the foyer collecting animals. Most of you wrote down a random animal on a bit of paper. I have those bits of paper. I did ask for a lovely Prada clear handbag to put them in. I thought it was a complete steal at £710, but finance did not agree. And so they raided the stationery cupboard and they gave me this lovely bag, which you can kind of see the resemblance. They put a little red thing at the top to make me happy. So could I just get you, just pull out a few of the animals. Yeah, just pull out like a handful. Have a read of them. I'll give you a mic. What did you write down, by the way?
Fruit bat,
that was a good one. Yes, what else have you got there?
Hamster,
that was a good one.
Elephant.
Yeah.
Owl,
great. So thank you for that. There were quite a few different ones. We had penguin, quite a few penguins. We had Bigfoot, which I really liked, as well as Donald Trump, so thank you for who did Donald Trump. And we also had the obligatory cock. So at least I assume that's what it was. It was a symbol more than a word, but I interpreted it as that, so there we go. So what I want to do now, I've put them in a little chart there so you can see the distribution of your animals that you chose. Now, isn't it interesting that we are in the tallest building in London and the most popular animal was a giraffe? Something in that, I don't know. They are pretty random. There's nothing there. Dog, I would expect dog and cat to be up there, but they're not. Here is the Google search volumes of the top animals. It's obviously a little bit skewed because you've got turkey in there, which is obviously the country and the food. You've got fish and lobster, which I assume people are not having lobsters as pets, and wolf, probably influenced by Game of Thrones as well. So it's not really correlated, but what I wanted to do is I wanted to see if I could predict, based on the data I have about you, what animal you would choose if I pick one at random, and then personalize the rest of this talk to that animal, right? So that's the theory. We've got to use this middle section. Can you throw this just behind you? Because I don't want you to think I've planted someone in the room. So just throw it. We'll do it twice, and whoever it lands with, as long as we keep it in the middle section, we'll go with them.
Should I do it like I am?
Yeah, just random. If it comes at you, do catch it. We don't want any lawsuits. All right, throw it one more time, and whoever that lands with, we'll use them. You can give it to your mate. Okay, perfect. Can I get you to choose a random, just dig in there, pull out just one this time. That's the one we'll be using. You can get in. You got it. Okay, don't read it out yet. What I'm going to do is I've predicted on the next slide. What's your name, sorry?
Katie,
all right. I predicted on the next slide what the animal that has been randomly chosen is going to be. If it's great and it works, it should be amazing. If it doesn't, then it's Katie's fault. So there we go. I'll caveat that right now. Okay, so on the count of three, could you open that and read out? Well, first of all, open it up. Is the handwriting legible? Can you read what it says? All right. On the count of three, you read it out. I'm going to change the slide. I think it's blank. Yeah, and then I'll make it appear. So my prediction is coming up when I click this. On the count of three, read out what animal you've got there. Yeah, go. One, two, three.
Raccoon.
Raccoon. Ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. That's the end. Now, I mean, I didn't say I was good at art. That's why I'm in digital, right? So the thing is, right? The thing is, it's good, isn't it? The thing is, it's not possible. It's not possible. It's a completely random choice. It's a small data set, and the being able to predict something like that is just not possible, right? I collected the wrong data, and so I couldn't do any of the other stuff, right? I can't activate it. If I had asked you your name, your age, your location, where you grew up, if you had pets as children, if you have kids, if I asked you those sort of questions, I probably could have put some model together that predicted what you're likely to get. And I actually put random animal on that bit of paper. If I just put favorite animal, then I probably could have guessed cat or dog, right? So I'd made the instant mistake of collecting the wrong data. And I see that all the time in companies. They collect the wrong data, and then when they try and activate it, they don't know what to do with it. It just doesn't work. So I always advise start at this end. Choose how you want to activate your data and work backwards. Then work out, right, how do we analyze that? And then finally collect it. Don't start here. Start here with a simple proof of concept and work your way backwards. So now imagine that I did ask you all those questions and I collected this particular data. And I was doing this talk every single hour. I need a process. I can't analyze all that data, put it into a spreadsheet, then do the segmentation, send it off to the creative team, they make my slides. It's just not possible. And this is the kind of stuff that you guys will see every day in your business. You've got to overcome these challenges. How do you get your departments working together? There's probably people in your companies who are amazing at data science, and they can predict a whole lot of stuff for you, but you don't know they can do it. And so it's sitting on a file on their computer, and you're not able to activate it. So how do you solve all these challenges? That's something that you really need to think about. So let me give you another example. Quite often in retail, one of the key challenges, is certainly in fashion, is to get someone ordering twice. Because if you've ordered twice, you pretty much have maybe interacted with support, you've probably done a refund or two, so you know the delivery mechanism, you know that they're efficient at delivering. So if you've ordered once, to get you to order twice is a key part of the journey. And you want to activate in all those systems. But the data you have looks like this. It's just a file in a database somewhere of all your list of transactions. How do you go from that to this and overcome all those challenges I showed you before? You need to get the data into some sort of useful form. So you need to work out how many orders someone's had, how many times they've been a customer, so on and so forth. You then need to segment it and send it back to these tools. And this red box is the most difficult part. This is where we are seeing customers have the biggest challenges. They can't do this. They do it once manually or not at all, and then they give up or it's too difficult. Solving this challenge is the key part. So as a little exercise, this is how we might approach that problem. So we use a lot of the Google Cloud. We get the raw output. It goes through this kind of pipeline, which manipulates the data, changes it up, and then feeds it into these systems here, and also Facebook and your marketing platforms. It's possible. The tech is out there. Generally, what holds people back is the people and the process within your departments, and people not working together. For those of you who are very techie, in this particular example, these are the products we use. But you know, you can mix and match them depending on what thing you're trying to solve. So, Penn and Teller, a bit of a segue, but Penn and Teller, famous magicians, and Teller is amazing at sleight of hand, right? He's kind of the magician of the two, I'd say. Penn's the showman, the larger one. And he has this great quote: sometimes magic is just someone spending more time on something than anyone else might reasonably expect. That example I showed you at the beginning from Flight Club, to me as a consumer, that is quite magical. That increases my brand loyalty. I enjoyed getting that email and sharing it. It's a bit of magic. It's a bit of an experience about that brand. And it makes me want to be more loyal to them. And why has that happened? Because they've just spent more time doing it than their competitors. So the thought I want to leave you with is, how much time in a week do you spend creating magic? How much time do you devote to solving those challenges that I just presented? Because you can bet that one of your customers or one of your competitors is probably out there spending more time than you and giving their consumers slightly more magical experiences. So I'm a bit disappointed I didn't get to predict the right animal. But I did actually meet this guy in 2010, actually, in Hammersmith, outside of one of his shows. I'm a bit of a fanboy. I've seen him 4 times now, twice in Vegas, twice in the UK. Been on stage as well. Had to throw a dart, actually, which is weird. It's kind of looped around. I had to throw a dart to predict something. And I asked him for some advice. I asked him a question back then. And what he said didn't really make sense at the time, but it kind of does now. I said, he said to me, Ed, you don't need just data. You need a little bit of magic and a whole lot of raccoons. Okay. Thank you very much. Oh. Sorry, I've just realized something. Because we're using Google Slides, some of you may think that we chose the animal and then I got the tech guys at the back to add an extra slide to the end, right? And that, as we're all very data conscious, that is a great hypothesis. And based on the data I've given you, that is a very accurate thing to have come up with, which is why I want to leave you with one more thought. Okay.